Hello and welcome to Living Black. I'm Carla Grant. Today we take a look back at some of the health stories featured in the program in 2014. First, to the Kimberley region of Western Australia, where our journalist Laura Murphy-Oates reported on the rise of methamphetamine use. Drug services and locals claimed the drug is spreading throughout the community and into the hands of Indigenous youth.
The picturesque town of Broome is best known for its pearl diving, multicultural community, and easygoing lifestyle. And when the sun goes down, the tourists come out and the party scene takes off. For many here, methamphetamine has become the new party drug of choice.
I suppose in the last 3 years, it's started to get to the street level, started to get into a lot of people's hands it shouldn't have got into. A lot of the Indigenous people have started to get involved with it. I reckon there'd be at least a few hundred that would be taking it on a daily basis, and their whole lives would be consumed by chasing methamphetamine.
28-year-old Cornell, a Yaru man from Broome, says he's seen kids as young as 15 taking the drug known as ice or crystal meth. He first tried methamphetamine 2 years ago.
Yeah, at first I was just sort of doing it on weekends and stuff like that, and then it wasn't long, probably 2 to 3 months before I was actually looking around for it, buying it myself. Life was pretty good at that stage. I was working out on the mines, doing 2 weeks on and 1 week off. Had my own unit with my partner and my little son.
As a fly-in, fly-out mine worker, taking the drug recreationally fitted in with his lifestyle.
So I wouldn't sleep for my whole week off, and then before I knew it, I wasn't in a position to be able to fly back out to work.
Little did he know that soon his car, his job, his house and his family would all be lost.
Probably 3 months after I first tried it, I was using it pretty much. It was a daily occurrence before I knew it. And it just came to a point where I'd pretty much lost everything that I had. It's a type of drug that it's quite highly addictive, and it doesn't take long before it grabs a hold of you. You do find yourself chasing the drug, and you're pretty much consumed by trying to get on it.
This is becoming an all too common story around the country.
Australia is facing an epidemic of crystal methamphetamine, or ice addicts.
We've compared it, for instance, to crack cocaine in the US.
Is a type of drug problem that we haven't faced previously.
Global seizures of amphetamine-type stimulants increased in just 1 year by over 65%. Use in Australia is higher than the UK and the US, with 2.5% of Australians over 13 using crystal meth. And by states, Western Australia has the highest rate of recent users at 3.4%. And it's permeating into Australia's most remote areas. In the far-flung towns of the northern Kimberley region, health services are raising the alarm. Andrew Amor runs Miliarumara Drug and Rehabilitation Centre, just outside of Broome. He says the 22-bed centre set up to combat alcohol and cannabis addiction is now treating 5 to 10 cases of meth addiction a year. It's a steady trickle that started about 5 years ago, but it's just one indication of what he believes is a much wider problem.
Cannabis is now taking a backseat. Amphetamines and even ice methamphetamine is now available, cheap, and is becoming the preferred drug of choice.
Marcella Hudson, a 39-year-old mother of seven, knows firsthand the harmful effects of drug taking.
Well, you start off with ganja. Ganja's the gateway. And then you turn to alcohol, and then the alcohol, and then you get, and then the amphetamines come to it, and it's just terrible.
Following several deaths in her family, Marcella turned to the drug to cope.
Amphetamines was just a terrible thing to have. It didn't help me in any which way, shape or form. It just amplified my grief.
After 3.5 years of addiction, she decided to seek help. She travelled from Carnarvon, a 15-hour drive north, to be treated at the centre here in Broome.
I'm so happy and glad that I've done this, you know, and reached out, because there's no rehabs or anything down in Carnarvon.
It's a lack of facilities and education that concerns Andrew Amor.
And we have been seeing for a while more remote communities having issues with these types of drugs as well. So we've already seen the devastation of alcohol. If we don't act now, we could see, you know, communities being hit again a second time with this drug.
For Connell, reaching out was tough.
I just didn't want my family and a lot of my close friends that I'd grown up with to know what I was doing, because I suppose there was that bit of a shame factor there.
He eventually saw a counsellor in Broome and flew down to a rehabilitation centre in Perth.
The most challenging thing for me was the start, was actually being honest with myself, saying that I actually did have a problem.
But the consequences of not seeking help can be devastating. Dr. Chapman regularly sees how the drug affects people, both mentally and physically.
So we might pick up on them hearing voices, this is auditory hallucinations, which may be quite persecutory. There may be elements of grandiosity as well, feeling, you know, that they have special powers or abilities. It can change at a moment from apparent euphoria to tears, sadness, or intense anger.
He says there's been an increase of people in meth-induced psychotic episodes, forcibly taken by police to be treated at the hospital.
Once every 2 to 3 weeks, we're seeing someone. Probably methamphetamine has provoked their illness episode. We have to use a lot of the hospital resources because of the risks, the potential for aggression.
However, the effects don't stop at mental health.
Hepatitis C transmission rates have been increasing.
At the request of local health organisations, Paul Dessauer has travelled from Perth to Broome twice this year to educate locals on the risks of methamphetamine use. He says needle sharing is leading to an increase in bloodborne viruses.
Unless they're taught right at the start to do it as safely as possible, we know that about 50% of people who do inject drugs contract hepatitis C.
And the lack of education around health risks is a hidden time bomb.
The real concern I have in these more remote communities is that most people who contract hepatitis C do not show any symptoms for 10 or 15 years. And if nobody is testing them, and if nobody has taught them about this disease, they may be spreading it within the community. This epidemic could be spreading without us realising.
The questions remain over where the methamphetamines are coming from and how they are getting into the community. Former users of the drug told me that they haven't heard of it being made here, but rather it's being brought in from places like Queensland and the Northern Territory.
It is a new and frightening thing for a lot of the people in the community. This isn't just happening in Australia, this is actually a global trend.
Cornell has been out of rehab for several months now. He's determined to teach his community about the harmful effects of methamphetamine use.
Something that I'm really passionate about is being able to work with Indigenous youth. I say to a lot of my close mates that this drug is wrecking a lot of young Indigenous people, and it's a very dangerous drug, and, you know, there is light at the end of the tunnel, and it's just good to be able to know that my future looks bright and that the things that I want to achieve, I can achieve.
And while the future looks brighter for Connell, the fight against the grip of methamphetamine on his hometown is just beginning.
If you or someone you know is suffering from substance addiction or abuse, you can seek help by calling the numbers on your screen. Coming up on Living Black, concerns over declining rates of Indigenous health workers in the top end. You're watching this special health episode of Living Black. Aboriginal people are suffering from ear diseases and hearing loss at a rate 10 times greater than non-Aboriginal people. But a health worker in Cherbourg is hoping to change that in an effort to improve ear health in Queensland communities. Hannah Hollis has more.
What we're looking at here is an insect. It's actually a fly. It's lodged in the child's ear.
Chronic ear infections can be devastating.
They just live with the pain. So the parents don't know what type of pain they're going through.
But it's all in a day's work for Cecil Brown. Hitting the streets of Cherbourg in southeast Queensland, this trailblazing health worker is changing the landscape of rural and remote healthcare.
We're going to check a child's hearing at the request of a mum.
Known to the community as Uncle Pickle, he's been an advocate for improving the health of Indigenous people for more than a decade, and now he's paying special attention to their ears.
Come in here, let's have a check.
For those suffering from ear problems at an early age, life can be more challenging.
So that's excellent. If a child can't hear, they can't learn. It's as simple as that. So your attendance rates at school goes up because a child can hear. If they can't hear, they're going to play up at school. You know, they can't hear. They're being maybe teased by other children.
And Cecil decided to do something about it. Taking to the road in his eHealth Piccaninny van since 2008. Every day he travels to daycare centres and preschools across country areas of Queensland.
The van is completely fitted out. I can do a full ELK check on a child. I've got me scales there. I can do their blood sugar levels, their haemoglobin test, blood pressure test, a high test, sight test, and also the videotoscope, the tympanometer and the audiometer.
Fitted out with the latest technology, computers and broadband, Cecil is able to seek the advice of medical experts.
When I'm screening, I'll go there, I'll capture the image of the child's ear. If we had a major problem, we've got the capacity there for me to ring Dr. Perry and say, look, I'm going to put this on our website now, our database. Have a look at this child. So it can be done just like that if you need to.
For working mums like Cherbourg local Melody Malone, Cecil's health service makes life easier.
It's a big, big, big plus for the community to have this service. It really is, because it's a lot less time consuming, especially when you've got a lot of children, which a lot of people do on Aboriginal communities. So
when the program started, it was designed to cater for Indigenous communities, but because of its success, it's available to everyone. And according to Melody, one van is not enough.
It would be good if the government can put a few of these mobile here, and I reckon they even need it in the city.
Cecil's work also acts as a bridge between health professionals and those in communities needing treatment.
In other communities we go to, they sometimes the kids are waiting up to 3 months before anything, at first they get assessed and then anything gets done. So it really delays the whole process of fixing the problem and getting intervention where it's needed, because it's around accessibility and comfort. If we come in every 3 months, we're kind of seen as people who are coming in from the outside, and it takes a while for communities to build trust in you. And that can take a number of years, so in that time, some parents' families may not be accessing service.
And it's that experience he passes on to teachers and healthcare workers who work or visit the community.
Key to the success of the program is early intervention. And when Cecil first started, he saw about 400 kids a year. And now, 6 years later, he's seen more than 5,000 pairs of ears.
Perfect deadly ears.
Yes.
The dedicated Uncle Pickle is modest about his achievements.
All you have to do is have a fully trained health worker, and for them to go out into those remote communities, it's ideal because it's mobile, and the use of modern technology with telehealth, it's ideal for that type of use. I get a buzz out of next time you go back and you see them and they fix and you're able to take them off the program. That's what I like to see.
So that's working.
Having parents come up and thank you for doing stuff that's fixing kids' ears.
But until then, Cecil remains focused on the job, continuing to change the lives of children with his innovative approach to ear health.
Last year, health services in the Northern Territory were concerned over the rapid decline of Aboriginal health practitioners. To address the situation, the Northern Territory government made a commitment to increase the numbers of Indigenous health practitioners by 10% each year. Laura Murphy Oates has more.
Hello. Hello, how are you?
Good.
Hello. That's good. Do you want to grab a seat over there while Nan gets blood pressure checked? Ben Halls is a 41-year-old Noongar and Martinamere man from South Australia. Working here at the Central Australian Aboriginal Congress Clinic in Alice Springs, he's one of over 200 Aboriginal health practitioners throughout the Northern Territory.
My blood pressure is good.
In the Territory, where 30% of the population is Indigenous, Ben's profession is helping to bridge the gap between the community and health services. On top of regular health work, they also act as translators and advocates for the Indigenous community, and they're a familiar face amongst a revolving door of medical staff in remote areas.
Just a friend. Sometimes you're an educator and a teacher, a doctor, nurse, psychologist. I think we do it all.
But the number of registered health practitioners is quickly declining in the Northern Territory, falling by 30% between 2000 and 2010.
When you see a profession that should be growing actually diminishing in size, that is alarming.
Most of the AHPs that I know were all over 40. So, and my mentors all retired.
In 2012, the role of AHPs went national, allowing them to work across state borders. But the standard for clinical skills and registration is now set much higher. Ben Halls believes that, and the extra cost of training, has driven people away.
Financially, not a lot of Indigenous people have the family back up, supported by a partner and family, whereas other people don't have that option.
The NT Health Minister says they're taking control of the situation, with the government committing to raising Aboriginal health practitioner levels by 10% each year, starting with remote communities like Wadare and Papunya.
There was an immediate response. For example, in Wadare, we had a number of former health workers that aren't trained as practitioners as yet put up their hands and say, "We want to be a part of this. We want to get back into the health service and start serving our people on community like we used to."
There's a crisis out there, and having acknowledged that and seeking representation of Congress onto this task force really recognises the expertise and experience that we've had on the ground.
Donna Archie is on the Back on Track task force, charged with reinvigorating the profession. She says lack of training options is an issue, with funding for on-the-ground training sparse.
Congress currently uses its service delivery money, which is an historical decision to do that, to train Aboriginal health practitioners.
At the Congress Clinic, Ben is training Lenny Cooper, a Yorta Yorta man and former teacher from Victoria.
One, two, three.
Lenny is reaching the end of a long haul.
A few year and a half I've been doing the book work for the Cert 4, and now I'm doing clinical hours, which is 900. The Cert 4, I've got a job for as long as I want to, so I'm really glad.
For Ben, training new practitioners is a necessity.
I think it's important to keep the cultural awareness and cultural significance going.
And his hopes rest on the next generation of Aboriginal health practitioners.
Still to come on Living Black, a catchy animation program aims to improve ear health.
I'm gonna bring the news, I'm gonna bring it here. You're not hearing me, you better check your ears.
Welcome back to this special health edition of Living Black. Aboriginal communities around the country are striving to improve the health outcomes for their people. And the community in Rockingham, Western Australia is no exception. Last year I visited their Health and Wellness Centre, which is changing the lives of the local Noongar community.
The Moorditch Court Aboriginal Health and Wellbeing Centre is working to improve health outcomes for locals with their innovative one-stop service.
Hi Jonathan, how are you going? Good to see you.
We're a health service, and we've gone from a health service to a voice for our community, a voice that wasn't there before. Our community have expectations that we do provide, you know, some kind of direction for others around housing, some kind of direction around legal and youth diversionary services, and start to raise awareness of the current issues in our community. We're not just a service, we're actually a vehicle for change now.
How you've been feeling, all right?
Yeah. I think this is one of the major stops for Aboriginal people.
That's all good.
They pull in, this is like a halfway house for them, pull in just for a yarn. If they need appointments, they come in and ask us. We'll, you know, go online, we'll find out any information and provide it to them.
The centre opened 3 years ago and provides many services, including dental, podiatry and chronic disease care for over 200 local Aboriginal people, approximately 10% of the Aboriginal population of the region. But it's also a place which operates with a culturally sensitive approach.
The majority of staff are Aboriginal, and the service providers come in and they're always going through cultural awareness training. And if the service providers don't understand, they're always willing to come in and ask one of the staff just to make that client feel comfortable.
To me, it's a family that works here, and it's good to know that our people have got somewhere to go and get help for their health.
Mudich Court, meaning good heart in the local Noongar language, is working hard to serve the community's health issues, and they're also supporting families in need.
Got to the point where we actually put in a proposal to have a bus to help transport people to and from funerals. So it's such a demand. Sometimes there's been 3 funerals in a week for community members here. It's a serious issue, the amount of deaths we have in our community, and they range from, you know, elders to young people in suicide. So it's hard to put your finger on any one issue to be able to solve, but we know as a community we've got a lot of strengths in our community, and we need to draw on those strengths and use those strengths to overcome the weaknesses.
While Mudich Court is providing an essential service for locals, its future may be in doubt.
All we know is we've been guaranteed funding up until June 30 next year. What that does around planning, it makes it difficult for us to plan long term if we only know we've got another, you know, 8-9 months left of contracts to be able to plan off. What we need is some long term commitments.
This is so important to the community just to keep the funding going.
For locals, this is more than just a healthcare facility. It's a place they can call home.
As we've reported, Indigenous ear health is at crisis point. 93% of Aboriginal children are suffering from middle ear infections in early childhood. The World Health Organisation regards 4% as a massive public health problem, requiring urgent attention. In the New South Wales town of Newcastle, a campaign was launched last year to tackle this problem. Ryan Little reports.
Well, listen up, cuz, cause my words are tired. I'm a deadly crew kid named Little Mike. I'm gonna bring the news, I'm gonna bring it here. You're not hearing me, you better check your ears. Your ears,
this is Little Mike, the rapping, dancing, animated star of a new campaign aimed at promoting the importance of Indigenous people looking after their ears, in particular the kids. That's the message that health workers at Newcastle's Awabakal Aboriginal Cooperative want you to hear.
Because as we know, blackfellas don't like going to the doctors, and there's a lot of fear associated with going to the doctors.
Australia's first Indigenous head and neck surgeon and leading ear, nose, throat specialist, Dr. Kelvin Kong, is a driving force behind the campaign.
What we're trying to do in today's media is to try and change that perception that it's cool to go see a doctor, it's cool to go to the operating, it's okay, it's not going to hurt you, it's not going to be harmful, it's actually the benefits you can see and partake in. I think they're the important message we're trying to get across in a fun way that kids can relate to, that kids can buy into, and that they're going to enjoy and actually get a message home from that perspective.
One of the aims is to reduce the number of children with undiagnosed hearing problems from facing a bleak future.
The problem with hearing disease is that hearing disease won't kill you. Hearing disease is a problem that affects your learning, your employment, your education, and that's the chronicity of the disease process, because there's so many life outcomes. You look at the underlying determinants of ear disease, and it all comes down to the social determinants of health.
Health experts liken the current state of ear disease in Indigenous communities to fourth world conditions, and the statistics back them up. 7% of Aboriginal children in remote communities have healthy ears, while 93% of Aboriginal children suffer from middle ear infections in early childhood. In remote Northern Territory communities, this ranges from 8% to 50%. The World Health Organisation regards 4% as a massive public health problem requiring urgent attention.
Ear disease is one of these horrible things that affects our communities too much. we have rates which are exponential. We talk about close the gap campaigns, but there's no use closing the gap if no one can have a job. So we need employment and education. Education starts with listening.
But there are simple solutions to tackling this health crisis.
Having good housing, having good food, having good hygiene, all those kind of basic things that we take for granted, and it's so simple.
See, are your ears playing up again? What? Oh. Has your mum been yelling at you? See, gee, that TV's loud. You deaf or something? What about Mrs. Prickle Pear?
Sis! Stop backing up! You haven't listened to a word all day!
While there are many complex issues facing Indigenous disadvantage, improving Indigenous ear health could prove a key factor in closing the gap. And just like Lil Mike says, if you can't hear, you're missing out.
Could see my hands and you're seeing me spin, but you won't know a word if you can't hear a thing.
That's the program for today. If you'd like to watch this episode again, just visit our website at sbs.com.au/livingblack. You can also follow us on Twitter and check out our Facebook page. On behalf of the team, thanks for joining us. I'm Carla Grant. See you next week.